shit, ladies and gentlemen. How you doing out there? This is Intergalactic Interviews, and this is episode 103. Or is it 103? Is this joke gonna die? How do we know? Ladies and gentlemen, the voice you're hearing is MD of the Boomsday Alliance. Some people call me Jayme. You can call me Jayme. To my immediate right is my beloved co-host, Michael Saavedra. How you doing, sir?
Oh, super duper.
On the boards and audio today, we have the magnificent, the glorious Garrett Wolf. Badoosh. How you doing, sir?
Not too bad, thank you.
Oh, yeah.
You
can already see our guest here on the video, I can tell, Mr. Steve McGowan. But before we get to the return of this illustrious gentleman, I think we should tell you about a little opportunity that you can do out there. If you have the access to the internet right now, you should go to floathouse.ca. What? Floathouse.ca. What website was that?
I believe that's floathouse.ca.
That's right. And if you go there, you are going to educate yourself on the premier isolation tank experience in the lower mainland. You know what that means? That means if you are capable of going online, you can get yourself a podcast promo code. And that promo code is what, Michael Saavedra?
You can say lowercase. lowercase.
It's actually lowercase i, like that.
I say whatever the fuck way I want.
That's right. This is your goddamn ad. Lowercase i podcast is the promo code, and that'll get you what?
20% off your float.
Sounds so aggressive. What will that get you, Michael Saavedra?
And to be fair, most people are going to read this afterwards, because I would hope that they would just stay on listening to the show and not just jump to go.
That's right. Jesus, have some decency and watch the whole fuck.
We're just trying to let you know.
That's right.
We're just trying to let you know.
The thing I like about Floathouse, though, is you get your own private tank, you get your own house coat, you get your own private service. It's amazing. It's self-development. It's awareness. We float. You should float. Try it out. Get 20% off your next float. It's goddamn amazing. And I'll just add this. Steve McGowan, he's an interesting fella. And he loves to float. You can just tell.
We all sound like turds.
That's right.
Just floating around.
That's right.
You get a house coat after. What color's a house coat? Like, so forget the float. Like, do I have to float for the house coat?
The color of the house coat is mother of pearl.
I also don't think that you get to keep the house coat.
No, I think you have to, hand that back in.
Float and then get it. Okay.
This is not one of your fly-by-night isolation tank experiences, Steve McGowan.
We're not slumming it here.
And speaking of that, our guest this week making his return is someone we've wanted to have one-on-one for a little while. Friend of the show, good guy, great beard.
Trimmed down.
He jumped in on short notice. We love this guy. Ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for the illustrious Steve McGowan.
Hello.
Oh.
Hello. Thank you.
Play golf clap because we were watching The Legend of Bagger Vance back-to-back in the bar, which is a terrible
choice.
Was that
what was on?
They had the golf channel on in the bar, and they were playing every golf movie ever, which apparently is Bagger Vance twice.
I've never seen that show, but it's funny.
Tomorrow night's Tin Cup back-to-back.
Tin Cup. Yeah.
What a delight.
Kevin Costner. Yeah.
Coming up next, Slapshot. Like, they just fucked up.
Slapshot 7.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is still filmed in Vancouver.
What the fuck? What's going on, man? How you
doing? Not much, man. Good. I'm good. I'm well. I'm here. Yeah, no, I'm just chilling, man. Just working.
I see we caught you between haircuts. What's going on with that?
Okay. You know what?
We're just going to start right away.
So
start hot.
I don't know. I think I kind of started that the whole...
I started noticing on Snapchat. I was like, there's a man that's not comfortable with his current look.
Well,
and he wants to get a haircut. What's up?
Well, I do. And I'm... Because, okay, so I went... I never get the same kind of haircut twice, which sounds really weird. Like, you stick with the fade or you stick with the whatever, right?
That's but right.
It's really weird. I always just try to, like, go in and I just... And I have, like, three... I bounce around between hair... I wouldn't call them hairdressers. They're just... I don't know. But because for one, I go to Magic Cut, so I don't think anybody there would be registered.
Jesus Christ.
As a hairdresser.
Steve McGowan.
Yes, one place I go to. I go to a couple places where they are, anyway, whatever. So I went to one place and I just kind of said, okay, well, whatever, just do it. Do whatever you guys want. Like, I just kind of, I go in there and I'm on my phone. I'm just like, I just need a haircut and then whatever they do. Like, I don't really care anymore, but... The last haircut I got, they did something that said they trimmed something, and I had the top was kind of long, and I was like, that looks cool.
Mm-hmm.
Not now. Now I'm just ungelled. You got raw, Steve.
This is
like, you got a marble shirt, sweatpants, sandals with no socks. And this is what I go, like I said before, I go. This is what I go grocery shopping at 10 p.m.
That's a beautiful look, though. That means you're casual enough with us and comfortable.
Yeah, it's a good look for ground beef, you know?
Yeah.
There's no gel on this show.
That's right.
But no, and I got whatever, and then I had...
Are you kidding? Have you seen this side of the table? No gel.
It's thick over there.
Creamed. Yeah. That's good. Yeah.
Who's using gel? Are you using gel?
This guy's more of a. I bet you Saavedra. Look at here. Go to Saavedra's hair on the video for a second. That looks like
it's just grease, bud.
Looks like just grease. Natural grease.
Loads of grease.
Which Pokemon is that again?
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Wolf coming at you.
That's right. High five there.
But then I just got the haircut, and then I've just been literally, like, it sounds funny to say no time for a haircut, but I really haven't had any time for a haircut the last 2 weeks. I've been on...
You're a man on the move.
Yeah, I'm a man on the move, man. I'm just doing, like, I've been on the island for just a whole bunch of shows, and then I work the day job, of course, and then I'm doing comedy, blah, 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 blah. But I really just haven't had time, or I just kind of forget. I'm just like, screw it. I'll just get the haircut. And then it just kind of grew. Now, I started balding about 4 years ago. This is as bad as it's gotten, so I think this is as bad as it's going to get.
So you're balding right now? I don't think you're balding.
A little bit, but I just kind of said, screw it. This is it. But I do. I need a haircut, but now I'm just kind of like, I'm just letting me, but I hate it. I can't stand it. I can't. And then I tried to put gel in it. Last Saturday, and I have really curly hair, and I put some gel, and it just kind of curls, and then it curls, and I leave the house. I'm like, oh, it's great, and then it's like, and then I leave, and then it, and then by the time I get to like a show,
yeah,
it just, and I sweat a lot on stage, and it just looked like a mess.
You don't want to get that shit in your eyes either when it starts sweating.
You're like, this guy showered in a puddle before the show. Like, this guy looks like shit. So I need a haircut, basically. How you guys been?
Great, man. Great. So glad you turned that around. That was good.
Yeah.
Nice. I figured we'd break the ice by, you know, breaking you down completely.
Sure.
And then, you know, work from there. Big weekend coming up. Headlining at LAFFLINES in New West in British Columbia.
Yes. The Royal City.
That's right.
I like it when they call it the Royal City. Like...
Oh, New West is a fucking very strange place in British Columbia. It's strange that, okay, first of all, it's up and coming. So they have, it's this weird.
It's up and coming. Well, it's been up and coming since 1927. It's still up and coming, you guys. Yeah, that's right. It's like each mayor every year just goes, just give it time.
check this out. I didn't know. I always thought New West was like two blocks.
Yeah, right?
And then
Columbia Street, that's it.
And then someone showed me a map, and I was like, holy fuck. There's a lot more
people
to this
live
place.
Here.
Yeah. I was like, what? Yeah. So,
well, and you're moving there.
I am moving there this weekend, actually.
I lived there. I lived there for the better part of a year. And and it's weird because I was there all the time, working at LAFFLINES, performing there, and all that stuff, and then when I finally, like, I kind of knew just Columbia Street. It was like a little mini Granville, mini Granville, and then when I moved there, it was like, obviously there's places, like, you go up the hill, like, Columbia's kind of like the bottom of the hill, and then you go up the hill, there's other places, and there's some nice places and stuff like that. There's a lot of heritage buildings and everything.
Super, super art, like,
very artsy.
Antique and art, yeah.
Like. Yeah, totally, totally. But living there, I was just like, oh, man, this is, it's strange living there. I mean, you're going to like it. I'm not saying you shouldn't move there, but.
It's weird when I say, like,
it's too late for that.
when I say it's, like, up and coming.
I love that. And that's, like, the new thing now. Like, it's up and coming. Yeah. Come to New West.
This is me trying to parrot what the realtor was saying to me. They're like, it's up and coming. You're going
to
love it.
All the realtor will say to people, like, so what does it have to offer? Well,
they're like,
it's
well,
up and coming. You said that 13 times.
That's right. Like, they're like, you're aware.
When
right?
is it coming up?
They're building a Whole Foods
down
the street.
Yeah, a Whole Foods. That's like,
so that's the thing. Like, what I mean by that is, like, there's this... because I took a little bit of a, like, you know, when a business opens, they have like a soft opening. I was there last weekend for Kwesi Thomas headlined, and I was like, I'm going to walk the streets, my new neighborhood.
Right.
So I walked around, and I was like, this is a weird vibe. And it, you know what? the weirdest part about it, the weirdest part about it was that, like it felt like I came in at like 50% complete on the gentrification or something. Like, there's like, it's like, there's only, I'm like, oh, that's a brand new condo tower. That's amazing. That's cool. And then it's like, oh, that's a pub that's been here since, you know, wood was a main export of this town. Like that's like, wow, okay, let's go from there.
They still use the bootlegging tunnel.
Yes.
Like, that's how the pubs get their booze.
I was like, why is City Hall on a hill? Yeah. Oh, to defend from invasion in case Seattle flares up.
Man, there's people in Davy Crockett hats still walking.
That's right.
Around. They're just waiting.
It's a very...
They're still waiting.
It's a very strange town.
It is, man, but it is. It's New West is... It is its own little... It's like, there's towns at time that's kind of forgot. There's towns at time... Like, I'm from Langley. Langley, like, people are like, you know, time just went, fuck it.
Langley, yeah.
But New West is just kind of like, well, you know, even time just went, it's up and coming.
Doesn't Langley... doesn't Langley have a...
It's up and coming!
It's up
and...
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
That's a Remax. So.
Oh, no. Fuck.
No, doesn't Langley have an Olive Garden?
Yes, it does. Yeah.
That puts it head and shoulders above the other tri-cities.
Cactus Club now and all that, too.
Maybe freaking Taco Bell out there, I'm sure.
Oh, fucking Taco Bell.
It was a Mucho Burrito, too.
Ooh. Mucho Burrito.
But I don't spend a lot of time at places out there. There's some good pubs and all that. But Langley's been up and coming for a watch out, because Older Room just updated the new Safeway. So Langley better step it up.
New Safeway.
That's
First of all, well, how you been? That's good. That's good.
Oh, God, I'm so sweaty. Always sweating.
You know what's funny? Last time I saw you at a show, it was a couple months back, but you had, like, middled, and then the headliner went up. Did a full like 45 hour or whatever, and then I saw you after the show,
right?
And you were very gracious and like, hey, yeah, I have time to let you approach me, which was nice.
Oh no, God, yeah. That's,
what?
Oh, yeah.
No, I know. God, I don't want to bring it up, but you know, you have a history. Yeah, it's like, what?
You may enter my bubble. Yeah.
But I walked up and you're sweating, and I was like, your set was like an hour and 20 minutes ago. What's going on? You're still sweating.
It's weird, man.
And you were like, yeah, you were like, if I sweat once.
Well, I'm known for sweat. I'm known for
Yeah, you're like, I'll sweat for 2 hours.
Yeah, it's weird because I will. Because
I sweat all the time.
Yeah, but I don't sweat. Like, it's weird. Like, and it's anxiousness. It's whatever. But it's so strange because, or it's just meat sweat. It's my diet is shit.
Meat sweat.
I eat a lot of pierogies. I'm single.
Hey.
So I. No, but I won't sweat before a set. Like, it's really strange. I won't sweat before a sweat. I'm very, very calm and relaxed and whatever. And then and then I amp myself up. And then, it's weird. Once I hit the stage, and then I just fucking let go, and it just, I'll sweat, and then I won't stop sweating for like 2 hours after. It doesn't matter if it's a 7 minute set, a 40 minute set, whatever. I will once I get on the stage, I start sweating. And other comics have made fun of me so much.
That's crazy, right?
I think I'm probably Vancouver's sweatiest comedian.
Really?
Yeah. There's other guys that sweat a lot. I'm not saying like it's because I'm working harder than other guys, but I just fucking sweat. Like my sweat has sweat.
When I perform on the regular, I used to have to like actually carry a sweat towel. I'll admit, I used to do that when it was actually more like I don't know, in. Right. Like more in like, oh, like, hey, make sure you bring a sweat towel on stage to swing around during the hype parts or whatever the fuck.
Yeah.
Stupid hip hop shit.
Dab your brow.
Yeah, I gotta dab my brow. Yeah.
I'll take a towel up with me and just kinda, but I always forget, I never use it. I always kinda just wipe, and I saw myself on camera one time and I was wiping, I was like, that just looks crappy.
Are you gonna use a towel this weekend at LAFFLINES when you're headlining?
I'm gonna use a bathrobe that I'm getting from here. Because I'm going to float.
I'm going to use
a whole robe and just soak that one.
That was the greatest back forth in terms of placement. Like,
I'm going to use the Float Vancouver on Cordova Street. This is Cordova.
In lieu of the hand towels they'll give you at LAFFLINES this Friday, September 2nd and 3rd?
Saturday, September 3rd, yeah.
Okay.
That's where I'm at.
Excellent.
We're headlining. I'm headlining.
That's good,
man. It's going to be fun, man. Yeah.
Who else is on the show?
We got John Bueller hosting, which is fantastic. He's one of the powerhouse comics that Canada has to offer.
Is he up and coming?
He's John Bueller's up and coming, yeah. And then we have the LAFFLINES is up and coming.
Yeah.
Well, it's in the heart of the up and coming.
It's ground floor right now for those guys.
It's the Royal City Club.
That's right.
That's what it is. We have so fucking New Westminster, the Royal City. Oh, just call it the Emerald City because there's some fucking characters along that street.
Oh my God.
But they're friendly. It's funny because New West has, like I said, like Columbia Street only has, like it's not very long, it's not very big, but there's a lot of action on there. And at any given time of the day or night, you see there's a small handful, it's about five or six. You know how like Vancouver has like Spoons?
Right,
has
all yeah.
Those kind of character kind of people that are kind of iconic to Granville Street. But Columbia has, I call him Tourette Tom. I don't know what his name is, but he's got Tourette's. Like he's known for, he's very harmless, but he'll sit on him and he'll just scream and shout and just.
What?
Oh yeah, I've seen families run from him, but he's very harmless. And he used to sit across the street from LAFFLINES, but I think they since asked him to leave politely, and he did. He moved down to he's always outside the Fresh Slice. If you're over on Columbia, go get a slab of pizza pie from Fresh Slice and go and talk to Tom.
Tourette's Tom.
He's fucking great, man.
Is he
harmless. They're harmless.
Does he respond well to that name? Does he know that he's Tourette's Tom?
You can't really get a conversation in. He's already having a conversation. He's like, hey, Tom. And it's like, wah-ha, fuck. But it's, no. So I'm at LAFFLINES Friday and Saturday. he's nowhere near the front doors, you guys, let me say.
No, how can people get tickets, Steve McGowan?
LAFFLINES.com. Very simple, LAFFLINES.com.
What is it, L-A-U-G-H? No, sir.
No, it's L-A-F-F. That's right. Because they're wacky. So yeah, John Buehler's hosting. I'm headlining. And there's also Lisa Person is a very funny comedian. She's going to be on. She's the feature act. And then there's some guest spots also. Some very funny guys. Sam Tawning and Joey Camiso.
Oh.
Yeah, who I call the Karate Kid of Vancouver comedy. He's the kid. He's the kid. He's an up and coming.
He's up and coming. he's the crown prince of the royal city. He's up and coming.
Sweeping legs like you wouldn't.
Jesus.
But yeah. So there's that. So we're gonna. And you're gonna come. You're gonna come to the show.
Yeah, I'll definitely be there. You gonna come up? You come up?
Yeah, probably next Friday. Schedule.
Yeah, Friday or Saturday. Maybe Saturday actually.
Yeah. There's one show. There's one
Saturday.
Show on Friday.
I actually have to move on Saturday, so Saturday it'll be my reward.
Well, there's one show on Friday, and then there's one show on Saturday.
That's right. So Saturday. So, boom.
Yeah.
That sounds good.
Yeah, it'll be a lot of fun. Thursday, I'm also there Thursday hosting their Fresh Faces Pro-Am thing. And then, yeah, then I'm on the move after that. Where am I going? I'm going September. Where
you got some things cooking.
Yeah, I'm at Yucks again. I go back to the island. I just did a little island tour with a booker named Andrew Roberts, who's totally awesome, totally really good booker. And he does a lot of theaters and pubs and stuff out there.
Yeah.
He does a lot of bands. And he's put me up in Courtney. We did, which was a lot of fun. We did like Langford, Port Alberni, which is just, you want to talk about an up and coming
place. Yeah.
Port Alberni has been up. It doesn't need to come anymore.
No,
it
just peaked.
It's like picture any town in like any season of The Walking Dead. That's like
Jesus Christ.
Honestly, man, it was so weird. I've never been to Port Alberni before. We go there and it literally, you know what it is? There is a lot of white sneakers and gray socks. That's what's happening.
Oh my goodness.
It was so weird. We get out and it was at this bar and it was on this like hill. First driving out there, we're driving out there and it's like you're going camping.
So it's like dirt roads.
Dirt road, yeah, pretty much almost. And then all of a sudden, I'm like, where is Port? Where's this place? Like, oh, we're almost there. I'm like, are you sure? It looks like we're going camping. Like, did we bring enough firewood? We're getting a microphone. We need firewood, guys. And then we get there, and it's this fucking town, and it's just this. It was really weird and bizarre. But
did you have to bring your own toilet paper?
It was, you know, no, they provided that. That's okay. In my rider for okay. Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we did, yeah, we did the island, did a bunch of places on the island, and then...
Are you a two-ply guy, or are you a...
I'm a three, I go with three.
Three-ply, right?
Only the finest for my butt.
That's right.
Yeah. But when you're in a pinch...
Okay. Three-ply for the crown prince of the royal city over here.
But, yeah, then we did Nanaimo a couple weeks ago, and then I go back. So I'm at LAFFLINES, so I'm just going to plug some shit here. I'm at LAFFLINES.
Please.
I'm at LAFFLINES. If you want to see the sweat tour.
That's right. That would be a great name for the tour, by the way.
Sweat tour.
Do you want to see the sweat
just
tour?
Just soaking stages.
Like, yeah. That would be the actual name. Do you want to see the sweat tour?
Do you
want
to see the sweat tour?
Do you want to see the sweat tour? That's what it should be. Yeah.
And it's funny because comics said it, like, the host will bring me off stage and they'll just be like, Jesus, great. It gives them a good, like, 2 minutes to make fun of. So I'm at, where am I? So yeah, I'm at the LAFFLINES and then Yuck Yucks that's the wrong month.
Oh, Jesus.
No, but I do go back out to Yuck Yucks, that's right. So I do LAFFLINES this weekend, and then I do Victoria. I go back to the island. I do the new Yuck Yucks out there.
Which is the new one, right?
Yeah, which they opened up a few months ago.
Does it still smell like fresh paint?
It does. I don't even think they had a brick wall put up. There's a thing that said brick wall coming soon or something like that.
Oh, yeah, I saw that.
Seen the pictures of that?
I did see that photo, yeah.
So I'm up there with Damon Schwitter, actually.
It's just classic brick wall comedy, folks.
Yeah, yeah. And then back to Vancouver on the 16th, 17th for the Vancouver Yuck Yucks. And then I go to Kamloops on the 23rd.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
See McGowan.
It'll be fun. I mean, you know, and then I'm going to. So.
You're fucking, you're one of my favorite comics to watch in the city.
Oh, thank you.
You're very high energy. You actually have this, like, great ability to connect with the crowd. I don't want to burn this bit, but I will say the last time I saw you, you debuted a new bit with.
Just good.
Phone.
I need to do
with
bits.
A phone with, that involves a phone and crowd participation.
Oh,
did you sort that out? With the is that can we look forward to that?
One.
Yeah, can we look forward to that this weekend?
Oh, absolutely, for sure. Yeah,
yeah, because that was fucking hilarious.
Thanks, man. Yeah, that was kind of just kind of a like I've seen a lot of comics use their phone and like screenshots and stuff like that, and I never really thought I'm like fuck I probably have some stuff on. Being on Tinder as long as I have, fucking plenty of fish. It's probably just a Rolodex of shitty conversations that I've had. Because like, I actually had gone back into. So I found that one actually. That was when I was in Kamloops before, and then I was like, man, that's a really funny conversation.
There's Tinder in Kamloops.
It reaches Kamloops. I know, which I thought was crazy. It was like after Chilliwack.
That's
you
strange,
think,
right?
You think Tinder would just be like, fuck this.
Yeah.
But no, it reaches. It rides that internet all the way there. Running Water, they're working on, but it's an up and coming.
It's up and coming.
It's up and coming.
It's the jewel of the Northwest.
No Kelowna, but hey. but Penticton's really pushing.
That's right.
But no, I went back and I went through all my messages on Tinder. And there's some really good. There's a lot of throwaway messages in there, like, you know, you'll match a girl and talk. And it's just, cause for the most part, for me anyway, I think a lot of people say, like, Tinder's just. It's just a flake fest. It's just people. It's
just people.
Hello, hi. Yeah,
just people.
I'm nobody famous.
Vancouver, yeah, yeah. That's
what she's saying, Vancouver.
Yeah, she's saying that. Yeah. Sorry, folks listening at home. That was we get people walking by all the time.
Vancouver number one.
She's like, who's the back of that guy's head? He looks like somebody who could be. Famous or
that's who
chubby.
I picture. Yeah, famous or chubby.
We should just have a camera right out there for that.
We should
shit,
have
you know,
for people walking
camera.
By for sure.
Yeah,
for sure.
We all do the need another camera because I'm just looking out there the whole time.
We should figure that out. We should sort that out. Get another camera. I could. We cut you off though.
No, yeah, I know. So I went. They like Tinder's just conversation. You start a conversation with somebody and then it's just like, hey, and then it just totally flakes out. It just totally flakes off. So I was like, man, there's got to be a lot of, and there are, there's it's a freaking Rolodex of shitty conversations. And I'm looking at these things, not from them, but also from me, like just saying dumb shit. So I'm like, there's some good stuff in here.
So, okay, just so.
I probably have about a good 5 minutes.
I'm engaged now, but my relationship started pre-Tinder, pre-Grindr.
Before all
let's
that
get
stuff.
It
yes,
equal,
right? Yeah.
Get
no,
a quality
hey,
out
let's
there.
Let's just be honest.
Pre-Tinder, pre-Grindr. Pre all the like.
Could be pre-Plenty of Fish. Plenty of Fish has been around
yeah,
for like a
Plenty
long
of Fish has
time,
been a long,
right?
It's been around for a long time.
Plenty of Fish existed, but I never used it.
Is that right, eh?
Yeah. Okay. I didn't need it.
Right, there you go.
Hey.
Oh, look at you.
I was always up and coming.
No, you were an up and comer.
Fucking,
right,
I, you know.
I can't wait until I'm up and coming.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, Phil, get there, buddy. Just visit the Royal City more often.
That's right.
I'll start somewhere.
We'll sort you out there.
Now you know the Crown Prince over there. Yeah,
good. Oh, I get a good word. Put
Crown
in a good
Prince
word
of the
for
Royal
me.
City. But, because I never had to use it ever, I actually don't know. There's like a bunch of stuff I don't know about it. So like when you say it's like a Rolodex of like previous conversations, so it saves. All your
it does, yeah. Oh, it saves the like you could.
So it's not like Snapchat or something where it like deletes immediately.
No. And it's. I mean, and I'm on Tinder now. It's funny because I stay on Tinder now more so for. Because here are now, I'm like, man, I got some good little screenshot bits about it and stuff. Like, and I'm hoping to get more from it. So I'm like, man, this is a great and not like I'm not. Trying to reinvent the wheel. There's a lot of comics that are getting a lot of material from the conversations on Tinder. I'm just starting to use my own now. Because I saw.
Yeah,
like that's great. Like,
like again, it's so good. So I don't need to burn it because it's fucking.
Yeah,
amazing.
No, for sure.
But like it it was one of the first times I've seen that in a crowd where it was not only dependent on the actual, like not prop, but like right. the idea yeah. that you had to use yeah. use an outside piece for a comedy, but also that the delivery of the audience member is like, it hinges. Like,
and I've maybe done it maybe about 20 times now, and you get some people. First of all, you got to get a girl who like a girl will kind of look at it and she's like, yeah. "Oh my god!" Like she'll read it. So now for that, because now for that, what I've done is I actually have a picture of oh, not yeah. mine, but like a really teeny tiny. So then sometimes, because you get some girl, or you'll get some girl, you got to make sure that the audience member is coherent. Because I've had one girl like, "Oh, I can't, that's right. I can't. What is that? Is that a Samsung? I can't read off a Samsung." Right. Like, I don't even touch anything that's not an iPhone. Get away from yeah. me. You're creepy. Right?
Ew.
But you look at them. Like, these are old. These are old messages. Now, I actually didn't have Tinder for a while, and if you bring the app back onto your phone, it saves all the messages. Now, this is messages going back. Like, there's material there, bro.
Jeez. Like, holy shit.
I know. These are all my... I don't mean to brag, but I match a lot. I don't bang a lot. I match a fuck ton. have I banged all these chicks? Nope. But, but I'm up and coming.
So if you match with someone and they match you, it opens a conversation. Is that how that works?
Yeah, so you match. They you don't know how Tinder match works?
I've never...
No, okay, so
dude, I have no reason to have it.
All it is, you match, you swipe one. If you match, you start messaging. You have to match the message.
Just to be clear, when mm-hmm. Steve was just showing us right now, the video will show it because he was scrolling for a while, but like he scrolled... Like
this is not a brag. This is not.
You scrolled at least 7 or 8, maybe 9 full swipes, like all the way down, like.
Oh, but that's
you were there when Tinder started. You were just like day one.
Well, yeah, I kind of.
Were you a beta tester?
I kept hearing about it, and I was like, "What's this Tinder thing?" I'm like, that's kind of weird.
What you need to do is get on the Bumble, because that one I think would prove even more hilarious. Bumble,
I've heard of Bumble, but I'm kind of in the dark on it. Is that the one where the girl has to message you first, right?
And that could prove to be quite hilarious, which it has been in the Bumble? Past for me.
I totally, you know what? I'm fucking download Bumble right now.
Steve McGowan, man of the people.
Because on Tinder it's so funny too, because like, and I have a new bit. Because a lot of my material right now is about, because I've been single for 4 years, so that's what I've been talking about, past relationships and all that bullshit. But I'm like literally
temporarily single.
Temporarily, yeah, sure, yeah.
Monday through Thursday.
And then I'm married to the stage.
That's right.
But no, I.
He's wild and crazy, like hilarious. We were talking about the worst intros that you give someone the other day. Me and Sparling, and it was like the. Right. He's dangerous and he's wild. Like the worst intro you could give someone.
He's one to look for.
Yeah, he's an up and comer.
He's coming up in the up and coming scene. Look for him when you're coming up.
Yep, coming up in the up and coming scene.
I'm downloading Bumble right now, but fuck it, why not? Well, it's like a bee. It's got a bee. It's like a bee. Bumble. Meet, date, network.
Oh, okay. My God.
Sure, network. Yeah. By network, they mean...
Yeah. Do you have to connect it to your Google Plus or something? Some stupid...
Now...
It seems like that's what they
see, have. And that's the thing, too. Is like, yes. I have a
new... You can sign in with Google Plus.
You could, right?
Sign with Facebook. Oh, so it is just like... okay, sure. So I... but I have a lot of...
material that comes from like this.
That comes from that, and yeah. like I haven't. It's kind of like, oh man, I don't want to talk too much about being. I don't want to be that comic. Oh, I'm single and blah blah. But I do have a lot of very relatable crap about it.
So I'm single now. Beep beep beep.
Yeah, exactly. Crap. Right. So it's like mine's just like, listen, I'm like literally, I used to say, oh, I did a head count of how many people are in my friends group that are still single. I just say because it's summertime right now. I just say this is the first summer, and this is true. This is the first summer, and God, I don't know how many years, 7 years that I haven't emceed a friend's wedding. This is the first time I've had off. I've emceed 13 of my friends' weddings.
Holy shit.
Yeah. Jesus. Always an MC, never a groom. That's
holy shit.
I'll probably MC my own wedding. That's how it's going to go.
That's pretty.
This is the first summer I've had off. Now, that's 13 of my friends. I've also, people that I've known, but there was two weddings I MC'd that I didn't know the people. I was just hired.
Hired.
So there's actually 15 weddings that I've done. Yeah.
Did you charge a pretty penny for that stuff?
Some of my didn't charge. I was like, nah, don't worry about it.
Good man.
A couple of the ones I didn't know. I'm like, fuck, I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know you.
Amy.
Yeah,
fuck.
I got to tell a tender story about your love.
It's a wedding, not a charity. Like, say goodbye your balls, mister. I don't know.
You're like, I'm sorry, did you say wedding? Cha-ching.
Cha-ching money.
Yeah.
But
we're in the process of like, we have, okay, we've been engaged for a year, haven't made a single plan.
Congratulations on that,
buddy. Oh, thank you.
Idiot.
It's about a year late. No, I'm joking. You're late.
You piece of shit. I met your lady. She's very, she's awesome, dude. She's very sweet.
She's very,
good for you, man. Good for you.
She, I don't know how
she is talked her into.
Yeah, she's up and coming. You know, she's a straight shooter. She's going right to the moon, you know.
She's awesome. She's a nice girl.
I don't know how I talked her into being with me for the rest of her life. That is a crazy pitch, if you think about it. The whole wedding booking, though, like, we've done zero planning, and we're coming up on the 1 year anniversary of being engaged.
Right.
So the plan was to get married 2 years from engagement. So I've done zero planning. Right.
So there's about a year that's gone by.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. So just this past week, I reached out to some venues just to see, like, you know, kick the tires. I'm like, you know, first of all, I did it like fake name kind of thing. and then that wasn't really yielding results. And I found a website. I'm not going to plug it because they don't pay us. But
no pay, no play.
But they do all the reaching out for you.
Right.
But you just have to give them, like, your name and all that. So, you know, my name's Jayme. J-A-Y-M-E. When you read that on paper. So I was getting responses back like, well, congratulations, Jayme. Speaking as a fellow bride, I just want to let you know that. You
know. Oh, that's like, funny.
Yeah, and I'm like, and like the fuck? I go back. I'm like, actually, I'm the groom.
But you could get it from a girl's perspective.
I know. Oh, for sure. I have a unisex fucking name. I'm no Steve McGowan, man of the people.
Man of the people. Man of,
yeah, actually, everyone in this room has, like, a really manly man name.
Garrett Wolf.
Michael Saavedra.
That's, yeah.
Steve McGowan. You sound like an action hero.
Are you fucking kidding me?
Steve McGowan. the action figure. Yeah. It's just, it's me in a bag of sweet chili Doritos and my phone. It's like, ready for action.
Action hero.
Steve McGowan with new Crunchable Doritos.
Runs through Tinder lists like crazy and matching.
But he doesn't pound. And that's my new, I got a new bit about it where I talk about, like, I convince girl, because it's tough, like, when you meet a girl online and she doesn't know you, that's kind of part of my bit, like, trying to convince the girl that you're not the creep, which I do a good job of, but I say really dumb shit, and I'm looking through some old conversations, and I'm finding, like, oh man, I've said some really stupid things to girls. And I'm going through these old conversations. I'm like, oh, this is great. This is gold. Like, I remember when I said that to that girl and she never talked to me anymore. I totally remember that. I remember when I started texting and started talking to that
girl. Like what?
You gotta wait to see it on Friday.
Oh, that's right. You can see this live at LAFFLINES.
You can see the failures of Steve's dating, online dating.
Available now at Saturday.
Saturday.
Just go to royalcity.com.
That's right. Yeah. Royalcity.com. They'll end up like the Rotary Club or something.
Yeah, it's probably like a fucking strip club or something.
They got some bees. So when you swipe, okay, on Bumble, ladies always go first. That's what their fucking thing
says. Oh my God.
So it's like Tinder, but
this.
Yeah, go ahead.
So it says, two people like each other and it's a connection on Bumble. The woman has to make the first move by starting a chat within 24 hours. If she doesn't chat Steve McGowan, the connection disappears forever. But men can extend one match per day for an extra 24 hours. What the fuck is this?
Let's go, yeah, I'm extending hard as fuck.
Jesus, Wolf. Wolf, you don't say much, but when you do,
just top to bottom, he's like, just so you know, right away, babe, I'm extending right away.
It says, but men can extend one match per day for an extra 24 hours. And then, did you see the fine print? Wait, but I'm not looking for women.
I didn't see that. Yeah. Wait, but I'm not looking for women.
I'm looking for girls.
Well, then you can extend yourself more times.
Oh. So,
Bumble.
Wait, what are you doing?
Getting serious.
You turn it into Grinder?
Bumble Grinder.
So are we, okay,
Grinder.
So done.
Spotify. On Grinder, everyone goes first.
Jesus. Oh, so I'm already in. But where's my... What? But where's my...
That's your face?
My... Oh, God. So you got to make your own... Oh, I got to change that. Hold on. I can't have... Ooh, we go to
actually, that would be a big piece. Just to say right now that he used his flyer for his... headlining weekend show a Saturday.
So these are no,
Friday
picks,
and Saturday.
It picks your last five. It picks your last five.
Put this on camera. This is his Bumble.
That automatically picks.
This is amazing.
Hi, I'm Steve. Would you like to go out on a date?
You could Bumble Steve McGowan.
This is what the point of view would be. Would you want, do you want that climbing on top of you?
Just,
yeah.
Just to be clear, though, if the girl that says yes to that and messages you first, boom. That's
well, you know what's funny? So it picks, I guess it picks the last five profile pictures that you had. Oh, God.
It's aggressive.
Okay, well, here's, that's not a bad one, right? That's just equally as worse as me drinking from a fucking coconut. So this is what, or a pineapple. This is what, another one. Hold on, it says shit happens. No, poop happens. What does it say?
Shit happens when you poop.
Shit happens when you poop. I'm not gonna fuck. Why? And here's me as a Ghostbuster. Yeah, I'm totally getting fucking laid. Give me a break.
There's so many chicks that are gonna go for that.
Well, it's like, know, when you start swiping, then it's like every girl has their like professional LinkedIn photo. So it's just like, yeah, girl in pantsuit. Pantsuit, 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 pantsuit.
Shillery, nice. Okay.
Well, at least it's not like fucking cat girl or baloney arm. Like,
oh yeah,
cat girl or baloney arm.
Fucking Wolf knows a lot about
Wolf. What's baloney arm?
Yeah, explain baloney arm. You fucking fuck.
Well, have you guys ever like noticed that there's a lot of those angles that are sort of like the upwards angle?
Okay. Yeah.
So when they're doing this angle,
it's like a selfie, but like,
yeah, it's the telltale.
Oh my god!
It's the telltale sign is when their arm is like a log of bologna.
I've never heard this.
So not what I thought you were gonna fucking say.
That is not at all. I've never even heard of that.
What's Jesus. The matter with you? Oh, fuck. I thought, yeah, that's not what I thought at all.
That is.
I thought maybe like. Fucking hilarious. I thought maybe like. Like.
Like.
Taking a fake picture and then it's not her and be like, phony baloney.
Oh, phony baloney. No.
That's what I thought. Was gonna
what are you, six?
Ta-da! Yeah. Oh my god.
That turned out fucking awesome.
That was so, I'm so confused. I have questions.
I'm so glad we're like, and we go to Wolf. And now we go to Wolf.
Okay, so I'm just keeping those two pictures on there.
I think that might be a good.
So then they got to swipe first?
Yeah. If you get a match for the end of the show, I'll be very impressed.
So those are my two pictures. Is that good? Is that I'm going with?
I mean.
What's that one?
That one. I was like, oh, look at this sharp-looking fella.
Fucking mouth breather. There we go. Okay. So then I just wait. Like, look at that girl. Can I swipe her? I can't swipe her, though.
Yeah, no, you swipe.
Oh, I swipe.
Yeah. And it's just like if they match you. It's the same way as Tinder. But
like,
then
swipe me a picture to the right. Means you want to connect.
Like, I was like, think, can we actually show people's photos on here doing this? Is that okay?
Why not?
It was so I didn't even think of light. It was saturated.
Like, whatever. Oh, whatever. Stacy, age 31. You fucking fuck.
This is pretty cool. Okay.
She's like our number one fan. She's like, I'm never going to do this again. I'm from Toledo.
Bumble. Ugh. Ooh, there's some.
Steve McGowan is now wasp, just going through his Bumble.
Some real wasps on here. Oh, that's God, I'm so lonely.
Let me ask
you. Okay. All right.
Let me ask you this.
Yeah.
Steve McGowan.
Yep.
How did you get in to comedy? We didn't really talk about this a lot. You're on Sunny Dollywall. We didn't get a chance to.
Right, yeah, last time I was here.
So I want to hear this. Right. How did you get your start? You've been in comedy for how long?
I'm coming up close to, I guess this summer was 5 years now, 2010. Close 6 years, I guess.
Six years. And what prompted that? Did you always have like an entertainment gene? And like, were you always like, okay, I love the, like it's the look at me kind of disease a little bit. Like
A little bit. I mean, I've always been an idiot. I've always been whatever this is. Ta-da!
Don't fuck with that.
I've always been an up-and-comer, really. Yeah. Really, Jayme. No. I've always kind of been the center of attention, whether I wanted to or not.
I see.
In elementary school, I mean, I remember I guess I was in grade 6. Jesus Christ, I'm dating myself. In grade 6, when Ace Ventura came out, I think I was in grade 6. Grade 6 or 7.
Yeah.
I would just, God, that we all love that movie so much, and I would just recite it at school. Like, I would go there acting like Ace Ventura, teachers would get mad. I'd get sent to the hall all the time because I was being super loud. And just, I've always been kind of, I don't know, those kids do ADD. It's like, I don't know, fucking just ate a lot of sugar and just fucking ran around a lot and talked.
Yeah, it was so, like, you know, pre-2000.
I've always been, let's take it back to when I was a youngster. No, I've always been just hyper and always liked the attention. Like I said, like whether I want it or not, I actually... this is true, and I kind of want to tell this on stage. I don't know how I'm going to do it yet, though, but I've always wanted to. I actually ran away from kindergarten. I was in kindergarten, and I ran away from school.
You would have been like five, right? Like four,
yeah,
five?
Five or six. Well, kindergarten, no, I was 13. And, and maybe it was grade one. I'd have to ask my mom. I was in kindergarten or grade one for sure. And you can even look. I went to Wicks Brown Elementary School, and I think there's a teacher there that still works there that can attest to this. I was in class, and there was an assembly. It's really weird because I remember parts of it very vividly. And there was an assembly, and I was misbehaving before doing something. There was a teacher assistant. I remember there was a teacher assistant, and she put me in the hallway, me and another kid, because we were goofing off, and she put us in the hallway. The assembly was happening. It was like one of those fun assemblies where you just kind of go and play games. And
they
make you sing O Canada or whatever. And so we're in the hallway for about, I don't know, however long. And then everybody's leaving. All the kids are leaving. And she told the other kid that was out in the hallway with me that he could go. But I had to stay. I couldn't remember why, whatever. But I had to stay. So I remember a few minutes had passed. And I was just in the hallway alone. And I was like, well... I'm sure this is what I thought when I was, but now thinking back, like I was like, fuck this. Of course, I'm not thinking that when I was that age. I was
like,
I want cookies. Like,
yeah. But you knew something was wrong.
Something was wrong. I was like, no, this isn't cool. And my parents lived somewhat close to where it was. It was like 24th Ave, and they were down on 16th. So it wasn't that far to go. And I remembered how to get there. So I was just like, I want cookies. I want to go home. This isn't cool. School's almost done anyway. And I literally, I ran away from school. But there was like windows, and I ducked down to make sure that nobody would see me. And then I got onto the road, and I was smart enough to know. I was smart enough to know as much shit as I got in for doing it. But I remember I was told I was smart enough that when a car had come, I jumped in the ditch to hide.
Because all cars are strangers walking for you.
Because I could have got kidnapped. I remember that was etched in my brain. Just stranger danger. So a car would come, I'd jump in the ditch, get up, and keep running.
Yeah.
And I almost made it. I made it down to 16th Avenue. And I had another block to go down 16th, and I made it all the way in. And I remember, I was like, it was so much fun. I was like, I ran away from school. This is great. Teacher assistant in her truck, I remember it was a white truck. She came, found me. As I was hopping in the ditch, she saw me. They bring me back. Don't remember all that kind of crap, but I remember getting back to the school. The whole school had been looking for me. I guess I was gone for like a good 40 minutes or something. Whole school's looking for me. I think it was also in the Langley Times. I think there was a small write-up about it. I'm pretty sure. I'd have to look. I'm pretty sure there's a small write-up about it. The whole school was looking for me. Students, teachers, my parents were there.
Oh, my God.
I didn't see them because I was hopping in ditches. I just remember the whole school was looking for me, and everybody was... I was the coolest kid, though, going into high... for the rest of elementary school, I was the coolest kid.
Easily. You were an up-and-comer.
Because when you're up-and-coming, you don't get stuck. You don't get... Nobody puts Shooter in the corner. That's like, come on. Nobody puts Stevie in the corner. But, no, so long story short, I ran away. I'd always wanted... I got the attention even if I didn't want it. Like, I just thought, oh, I was just going home. Screw this. But the whole school was looking for me. There's a fire department was there. Cops were there.
So you already had eyes on you all the time. So it was already, like, just kind of thrust upon
you. Oh, totally, totally. And for good or bad, I always get, you know, I'd always be getting, I'm still getting in trouble for dumb shit. I never grew up.
So fast forward through school. Did you have any kind of performance background in high school?
I was involved with a lot of the arts and crafts and all that stuff, or whatever it was, for stage. There wasn't a lot of plays that they did at my high school. There was a few, but I did more of stagecraft is what it was called.
I see.
Stagecraft, where you make all the stuff for the stages.
So you do like set dressing and things like
that. Stuff like that. And then there was drama class. I remember I took drama class a lot. I was smoking a lot of weed too in high school and dropping acid and all that kind of stuff as well too. So it was a lot of just kind of goofing off and but our teacher, Mr. Fatkin, was our drama teacher, and he was fantastic. He didn't care what you did, if you were smoking weed or whatever. As long as you came to the class, participated in some way, it was totally cool. So there was no, it was just really cool. We was laid back. He let us goof off a lot. There wasn't a lot of plays in productions that they did, but I was very interested in getting into film and acting and stuff, but I never really went down that route. I just didn't go down. I would still like to this day, but I just kind of started, I emceed a friend's wedding. Fast forward a little bit more, I emceed a friend's wedding in like, oh, I don't know, 7 years ago or something like that. And I was like, yeah, that was kind of cool. That was fun. Because what I did was I had a speech written.
So about like 2009-ish?
Yeah, about 2009-ish, yeah. So okay. From high school to then, I was just just goofing off at parties, making prank phone calls. I'd be making pranks all the time, which I still have recorded. I'm actually going to do them again. Why? Because I'm immature and pranks. Pranks never get old. But I would, I'd go to parties and I'd have my own voice. Jerky Boys was a big thing back then.
Big time, yeah.
And I had my own voices, of course, and did my own little stupid things. And I record them and then put cassette to CD, which back then was next level shit.
Oh, yeah.
That was like how do you get that to that? And it was like a process. And then I was actually selling the CDs. I was selling them at parties of my prank phone calls. And I probably did over at least easily over 100. And I was selling these CDs to people for like $20. People were buying my prank phone calls, bootlegging prank phone calls. Yeah. And then I still have some of them on a computer that I have at home. And it's been years since I've done them. I've been wanting to do them again. I'm like, man, that may be funny to do again.
Yeah.
But now I'm like looking like, how do you do that? Because I had a cassette player and a fucking get a speaker.
It's a whole new game now.
Yeah. So then
the NSA's got you beat, bro.
Yeah, I know. And then I emceed a friend's wedding. I had a speech written, and it was really lame and cheesy and stupid. And so I was like, he really loved, he's a big fan. My buddy that was getting married at the time was a big fan of Christopher Walken. And I don't do impressions on stage. I don't do a lot of impressions, really. But off stage I do and stuff. I was like, how am I going to make this funny? So I was like, at the time, you know, I had never done stand-up or anything before. And I was like, I'm going to do this speech as Christopher Walken. And I did. And it was a big wedding. It was a big Italian wedding. It was like 300 people.
Oh,
there.
Shit.
And grandma was sitting up in the front. And it was,
No pressure.
Okay, no pressure at all. And I just went up, had a few drinks, and then I did this whole speech as
wow.
I was like, wow, you'll be fine. And I just did the whole thing as Christopher Walken, and people were laughing. I was like, ooh, this is fun. And then a friend's like, ooh, you should try stand up. And I'm like, no, I shouldn't. Maybe I should.
Oh.
And then
was it. It was from
It was from emceeing a friend's wedding. It was from the first wedding. It was from emceeing a friend's wedding.
Wow.
That got me, and I was kind of like, oh,
that's,
okay.
That's super cool because that bug,
yeah.
Once you get it, it's like, ooh.
It was kind of already there. It was like a virus that was in me already.
That's right. You were a carrier?
I was a carrier. And then something just bit and released this. Yeah, but it was really, I never did impressions on stage. It was just that presence of being up there in front of people and going, hey, this is something funny that I wrote. Yeah, let's try that. And then I think a week later I tried
stand-up. That response, like that initial response when you're like, wow, I'm actually running this crowd right now.
Yeah.
Like that first feeling. It's nothing like it, man. It's
no.
Nothing like
geez,
it.
Jeez, no. And I remember the first time I did stand-up. Actually, it's funny. I don't remember doing it. Not because I got so drunk, but because I had a couple beers, as you do. But I went up. It was a five-minute amateur spot. And I went up. And I was so... I get like that to this day. I get so anxious. It's not really nervous. I don't say, oh, I don't get nervous. Everybody gets nervous. But mine more so get... I just get really anxious and like I just want to, ooh, let's go, let's do this.
Yeah.
And then everything just kind of takes over. And then I remember I literally like blacked out my first, and I went way over time. I can't remember. I wish I could remember who was hosting at the time.
Just eating the light.
Mix. Oh, yeah. And I got in trouble from the manager. And I'm like, that's not something you should do. I know it's your first time and blah, 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 blah. And I went way over time. And I just, where am I? What happened? People were just laughing and then fell in love with it and stuck with it. I still get like that, though. I mean, you get the nerves, but mine just kind of turn into this energy, and then I use it on stage if I can.
Well, you're very, like we mentioned earlier, you're very kinetic, you're very active, you're very explosive.
Right. Yeah.
it's great to see, though, like, that you use that, because that feeling, that, like, anxiety before a show,
yeah.
I don't get stage fright ever. I don't know if... Do you relate to that?
Like, not necessarily stage fright, because
it's the anxiety.
Yeah, for sure.
Like I just want to do it. Like my favorite shows I've ever done have been the ones where like I literally show up and it's immediately stage time. that kind of thing. Yeah. Like, I really dislike
the, I can't, yeah.
the waiting around. Hey, how you doing?
Yeah. Like, see, I like don't to, like if that. I can, I like to get to a thing early and just kind of feel the vibe.
Oh, that's and, opposite. Yeah,
just, totally oh, is
opposite.
That right? Yeah,
having
I know.
A drink or two before, like,
yeah, like just kind of, yeah, and just kind of, like, all right, and kind of think about, see, I try not to think too much about what I'm going to do. Like, if I have a set list, I'm kind of like, eh, okay, but... I think I get so like concerned about the first couple of minutes. I want that crowd to eat out of my hand the first minute, as we all do as comics. You're just like, that's what you want.
But that ambition. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, yeah. And just sometimes you, yeah. then you don't get it and you kind of chase it a little bit. And then of course it depends on the crowd and all the variabilities and all that. But in the end, if you're funny, you're funny. So hopefully
that's right.
it, can,
yeah.
it can work. I mean, there's been times when I'll come up, they're like, all right, fuck, let's do it. Ah! And then it's like, okay, they're not feeling the energy. Let's slow it down a little bit. And slowing it down is really hard. I've been trying to train myself to slow things down on stage. It's really hard for me to do that.
Because if you come out at an 11, there's nowhere to go.
Exactly, like
it's only down.
It's really. Only down. So yeah. if you're coming out at a full 11, you got to stay
yeah.
at that 11. Maybe come down to an 8, give them a breather.
Yeah.
And it's funny because Ross Dowk, actually, very funny. Vancouver
very, comic, very, funny, very guy. Funny guy. Very funny guy.
We were on a show together at Yucks, and... He pointed out, he goes, you always take a beer on stage. You have drinks on stage, but you never really drink from them. And he goes, because you're talking. I'm like, I know, but I'm trying to take drinks on stage more because I'm trying to drink from them so I can give myself that little second of result. Yeah. Go. And then I'm like, oh, wait a minute. If I have a drink, and then I'm starting to think. Or water, whatever.
There's so many things right? going through your head, though. Like so many. The pacing of the laughter is like,
yeah.
First of all, the variable there of like, oh my God, they're laughing a little bit longer than they could have, or they didn't laugh long enough. Oh my God. And then you're like, I have to jump right back
in. That's where like your guest spot is when you're doing a guest spot and you got like 7-8 minutes and you're like, yeah, I gotta kill in that, or like a showcase or whatever. And you're like, I gotta kill this for just that 7 minutes, but I gotta like, what do I okay, I'm chopping my jokes up, I gotta put it all in there and still kinda, you know, get it. But then if they're laughing, you're like, oh fuck, shut the fuck. But you never want to talk over a good laugh.
Yeah, yeah.
That's, you know, you don't want to rush through the laughs, but sometimes you're like, shut the fuck up, guys. I got to get to my next joke, and right? Unless you just tell one joke and they laugh for fucking 3 minutes, right?
Yeah.
Then, hey, great, you're the world's best comedian.
Happens all the time.
It's usually good to have another joke in there, but yeah.
That's just another day in the life of the crown prince of the royal city. Up and coming.
I don't even live there anymore. I went back to, I'm slumming it in Langley again. That's where I'm happy in Langley, man. Langley's good for me.
You're doing good.
Yeah.
You're a good sport. You let Wes Barker take shots of you on Snapchat.
Wes Barker, yeah, that's good. He's the that's that magic boy, right?
That's that magic comedian, isn't
that's
it?
That's that magic comedian, yeah.
Yeah, he had kind words for you last
Oh, I'm sure he did. Yeah.
I was gonna say,
did he enter the room with a cloud of smoke?
That's what I was hoping.
When it just comes out, ta-da!
Actually, afterwards he was like, you know, because Wolf was like, do I have to put a camera on his hands? And I was like, why? And he's like, you know, for tricks. And I was like, I don't think I'll be making him do tricks.
Well, you're going to watch that baloney arm. You're going to watch that baloney. Those magical baloney sausage fingers. Yeah.
Dude, I was hoping to see something.
It's funny, though, because, like, you know, I guess, like, that would be the idea that, like, hey, come on and do some tricks or something. But, like, I was saying, like, I'm like, if you had... you know, Jose Batista on, you wouldn't be like, all right, now you're going to hit a few dingers.
Yeah,
like,
right, yeah.
Yeah,
it's Wes is good, man. He's got a lot of stories and stuff to tell, too. He's good shit. I've been trying to get collaborate a show together with him.
Yeah.
That we were going to do.
That'd be good.
Yeah, we were going to do him before, but it was just the timing of the year didn't permit. And he's a super busy guy anyway, so trying to catch him is tough.
Yeah. Man, he's a... He's a good guy.
He's done some things.
He's done some things. Hey, he's no Steve McGowan.
He's no up and comer.
He's no action hero, Steve McGowan.
Fucking. I don't know. We just went to Sylvester Stallone with helium in her voice.
That was weird.
Hey, what's going on?
I would be remiss if I didn't bring up today. This is only the second time this has happened in the series of the show, but
a member of the entertainment community passed away in such a notable member of the community passed away. Not to bring the show down, but I just Gene Wilder passed away today. And last time someone passed away of significance that was the day of a taping on our show here is Robin Williams.
Oh, really? Yeah, you guys were doing a show and he did too? I had
Fatima on that day.
Oh, okay.
And
Gene Wilder, man.
It was like, I found out 5 minutes before we started recording. So it was like, I processed it on the show.
Is that right? Yeah. I didn't find out. I found somebody had a posting that a couple people on Facebook were quoting things from his movies and stuff. And I was like, yeah, I know what that's from. What's going on? Yeah. And then I saw, Gene Wilder dies at 83. Blah, blah, blah. I was like, oh, shit.
Do you have a favorite Gene Wilder film?
I do. I have a few. Of course, everybody loves, you have your Willy Wonka and all that kind of stuff. And then any given movie that he did with Richard Pryor was great. We were talking See No Evil, Hear No Evil. Yes. It's fantastic.
Yeah.
Stir Crazy was great. Absolutely. Hanky Panky. Remember the movie Hanky Panky?
I don't recall that one.
That's a good one. That was a good one, too. But for me, one of my favorite roles that he had was in Blazing Saddles.
Waco
Kid.
Yep.
And there was just so, I mean, Gene Wilder, he's kind of a one of a kind, not kind of, is a one of a kind, just his delivery and his whole, just whatever. It's just Gene Wilder. Like you have your styles of comedy, then you have Gene Wilder.
Mel Brooks.
And there's so many good parts in Blazing Saddles that I always laugh at, steady hand, right? Oh, but I shoot with this one. Like, it's just great. It's just silly. With him and the
these are simple people.
Yeah, it is just simple. It's just like, what's the one part that always cracks me up whenever it's on well, it's funny because whenever they play Blazing Saddles on TV, if it's anything like, do you bother? You have to edit everything,
Why
of course.
Why would you even watch Blazing
Saddles? But him and the sheriff, and they're sitting there and he goes, oh, what do you like to do? And he goes, oh, play chess. Play chess. Screw. Let's play chess. Yeah. It's just, I don't know. Just the Waco. That role that he did in that was, it wasn't like a huge role that he had in that, but it was, I'd say, but I mean, Willy Wonka's so good too.
He's
so good. Like,
you know,
when that's a part of everybody's, like, remember, like we're talking about being in high school and all that. Remember movie day? They would have movie day.
Yeah.
And it would always be like, it would either be like James and the Giant Peach or whatever that one was. Yeah. And then Willy Wonka. And it was just, that was the movie, because movie day, like, oh, I'm just going to fall asleep. It was going to be boring. And that was,
James and the Giant
Peach. Do you remember James and the Giant Peach? What the fuck? Do you remember that?
Sorry, I just processed that right now.
They're going to do a remake of that. You just fucking wait.
James and the Giant
Peach. It's probably already being made.
I definitely slept through that in grade six.
Starring Jack Black.
Starring Jack Black. James and the Giant
Peach. But that sucks, man. Yeah, Jim. Well, but I mean, I guess,
I was going to say, one of my favorite stories I've heard about Gene Wilder was, during the filming of Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, actually a fox. Yeah. So it's really cool.
I don't know. Fact. Well, the Johnny Depp one.
Well, he's up and coming. He makes his own titles.
I didn't like, did you like the Johnny Depp version of the Charlie and the Chocolate Factory?
Did not watch it.
Nope.
No, I didn't.
Watch it. No. But, that's another Gene Wilder story, but during the filming, apparently, the story goes that, the initial reveal when Willy Wonka, the character Willy Wonka, comes out with his cane and he's, like, hobbling down. Yeah. And then he casts the cane aside and does this somersault roll and comes up, pops up, ta-da, kind of thing. Apparently, that was all Gene Wilder's idea. That was not in the script. Apparently, he said he wanted to do that because what it would do is, to the viewer, it would make you not expect anything for the rest of the film.
Right.
Right. Cinematically, because you see one thing and you, when's the next reveal going to happen? Yeah. It just totally threw things off. And I think that's beautiful, man. And that really speaks to the type of mind he had. He had such a great knack for understanding comedic timing.
Yeah. Trying things.
Even like his serious parts of that film, like the the meme worthy of, like, good day, sir.
Yeah, good. You get nothing. You lose. Like, good day, sir.
Like the
because he got of, I remember even when you watch it now, you're like, God, he got mean there. He got mean,
and you feel that. And
you
I remember as a kid being like, I like to turn that film, like, I turned the VHS off before. I'd be like, yeah, I'm good. Like,
you know what some parts is when they go through the tunnel. How creepy was that? That was just...
Where we're going. It's flowing.
Don't do it. Spinning.
Oh, and if we're spinning, now we're flowing.
There's like a fucking snake.
Ever growing.
It's like, why? Why? I know. That part I don't understand.
I always just assumed Grandpa Joe was tripping.
Probably. He's just probably. Like, that didn't happen to anybody else but him. He's like, anybody else see that? What are you talking about? Nope, like, nothing.
They're going to get you, Charlie.
Never mind, Charlie.
But, no, yeah, he's a beauty, man.
Absolutely.
Sure. Super talented, dude. I was going to say, just on a side note, first time I saw Blazing Saddles, I was on a athletic trip for, like, basketball or volleyball or something. And a fellow Mick friend of mine, I won't say his name, but another Mick.
Another Mick
in Northwestern Ontario.
Mick. It's semi-racist, but I'm white. It's cool.
McGowan, McDonald.
It's all right. Easy. We don't get the racist that often.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah.
It's another Mick.
Good thing there's no Max around.
That's right. Stomped out.
Yeah, this friend of mine, he plays, first of all, he tells the teachers that, hey, I want to watch a show, and they're like, sure, what is it going to be? And I mean, at this point, Blazing Saddles is like a cult classic in the late 90s, right? Yeah. So it's already a classic. So he's like, oh, what are you going to play? And he's like, oh, it's just like a cowboy movie, like a John Wayne thing.
Oh, no.
And then he threw on Blazing Saddles, and it took the teachers about 2 minutes to be
for sure.
Yeah. Right? Because right away. You know. So anyway, I remember saying like watching it, because we ended up talking our traveling supervisors, whatever the fuck. We managed to be like, hey, like, come on, just whatever. Like, just watch it. And we're like, we went to a Catholic school, so this was a big fucking thing.
Oh, jeez.
So we ended up watching it, and it's hilarious. Videos out there. But we ended up just going through it. But my initial thought was, I couldn't get over the fact that, like, I'm like, Willy Wonka is in another film?
I'd seen him in something else.
Dumb. Yeah. I was like, what? Yeah. Like, what the fuck? But he was going hilarious. On. Yeah. So fucking. Yeah.
See, with Blazing Saddles and me, my dad showed it to me way too early. It was like, I was like 4 or 5, I think, somewhere like super young, and Blazing Saddles came on TV. They weren't editing movies in the 80s at that time.
No, they're just like, play it. Give you a warning, and then that was it.
I watched that movie, and like, I laughed my ass off, like, with my dad. He says, you're laughing along with him. This is obviously the funny part.
Yeah.
Then I started watching, you know, like, fucking Tombstone and Unforgiven, like, later on, and I was like, that movie fucking sucks. Like, that last one was way more funny than this. Like, and like, I've always held, like, Blazing Saddles and such. I'm like, Young Guns, get the hell out of here, Emilio. Come on.
You know what? Wyatt Earp. Hell of a gunslinger, not much of a performer though.
That's right.
Had no comedic timing. Had no understanding of beats.
Oh, jeez. I have Blazing Saddles, of course, as we all, probably everybody has a DVD or a Blu-ray of it, but I haven't, it's probably been about a good 2 years since I watched it.
Probably, I imagine, in the next few weeks, it'll be a lot of
watching. Number one torrent right now.
Oh, for sure.
Right now, yeah.
One thing I think, I hope doesn't happen, which may happen. I don't know, maybe it's not such a bad thing, but I was thinking about it today, with his death today, with Gene Wilder's death, the time of this recording is right at the end of August, so going into September. It's just prime time for a celebrity death that Halloween is coming up.
Yeah.
I'd like to see it maybe be tasteful out there, but I doubt it.
Waco kid and the sheriff?
I just can't see it being...
People would think you're just doing a cowboy.
That's true.
Just doing a cowboy.
You'd have to have
You'd have to have the role. You'd have to say some things.
You'd have to, yeah.
Oh, no. And you're getting beat up.
That's right. You'd have to keep your parties to a certain...
Yeah.
Certain.
I think Willy Wonka would be more the...
Yeah. I think the top hats are going to be in full force.
I think this Halloween you're going to see a lot of Harley Quinns, Suicide Squad. You're going to see a lot of girls with the whole thing. You're going to see a lot of. I haven't seen Suicide Squad and the whole Joker, the Jared Leto. They just call it Surrey Squad. They look like shitty Surrey fucking scum. They do
Surrey Squad.
I get it. Like, the Joker's got like shitty tattoos, like fucking just fucking green hair. Whatever.
I was out as soon as they said that they made Killer Croc talk in like full like, I'm from the street. I'm urban. I'm Killer Croc. And then I was like.
Oh, dude, terrible. And everybody's like, well,
I did not watch it,
but I have listened to the soundtrack about 22 times.
Yeah, the soundtrack, sure. But this is what I heard is just it's one joint. Right. They worried more about the music, and it was just intros of every.
I heard.
No, they tried to rip the Guardians of the Galaxy like.
Well,
that.
Yeah,
like,
you know, what a great soundtrack.
Forgotten
that
Sons
was.
Introducing See, Killer Croc.
Marvel
and you're like,
has
yeah,
set. I'm
hell
sorry,
out of here.
Marvel has just set the bar like what DC needs to do, and I will get into this with any DC fan. What DC needs to do is just take a couple years off and reboot. You fucked up.
That's right.
You fucked up.
Wearing a Marvel shirt. This doesn't get more official. Doesn't get more official than this.
Yeah, like I'm sorry.
Like DC, you fucked up.
I won't nerd out too much, but I mean they did.
I'm gonna put up a name bar there that says CEO of Marvel.
Stanley, I'm up for hire. Yeah. But they I don't know, man. It's just the whole.
You're right though. They rushed it out the door. They fucked it up because they wanted the Avengers success. But the Avengers success came from about 6 to 7 years
of
film.
They took their time.
It made sense because by the time you had a culmination of that, I mean, they still got fucked up in the Avengers by not having Spider-Man, by not having the rights to that. You know, now they have that.
And even with their like when the Hulk came out with Eric Banana, when that came out. That was it was a shitty Hulk movie. And it was
terrible.
And that was kind of around the time they're like, what if we did
he
more Marvel characters?
Yeah.
And they're like, let's just scrap this.
He did.
Yeah. Throw in Edward Norton and just try it again, which they did and it worked. And
I
even
love
Edward
Norton.
And that Edward Norton was good. And it didn't really matter who you got playing the Hulk, but Mark Ruffalo was great.
Fantastic.
Yeah, and then you have your Iron Mans, you have this, you have your Thors, and you have and they played all these parts and then they kind of put it, they had all these good ingredients that were working. Put it in a pot, made the Avengers, and it was fun. It was just fun. It was done well. But this fucking DC, DC's like, oh, we can do that with Justice League. Sure, let's just, Man of Steel, that was great.
Yeah.
Let's fucking take that and just chop the shit out of it. Batman versus Superman, oh!
Yeah, Alex Sparling.
That's what happened. They took a dump. They took a dump and they said, all right, let's try that.
I thought you were splooging because it was so good.
God! I'm sorry. Before I watched it, and somebody said, "Like Man of Steel was good," I thought it was enjoyable. It was good.
I love Zack Snyder. I think he's a fucking amazing director.
What's he doing now? He's doing this shit. I know, and it's like when somebody before I watched the movie,
it's tough. Like
I got into it with a guy at Toy Traders in Langley.
Toy Traders.
I got into it with a guy at Toy Traders that was talking because now they got the
yesterday.
Because they have Game of Thrones toys up there, and the guy who played Khaleesi's thing in the
Cal
first
Drago.
Movie, yes, he's now playing Aquaman in the thing. Actor. Yeah. So I'm like, hey, that looks like Aquaman, and the guy's like, oh, I know, and he got really, and I kind of look. I'm like, oh god, this guy, you're a fan of the here we go. And then he's like, no, Batman versus, and we got into it, and this can win any argument that you get into somebody who loved Batman versus Superman. Because when I first heard about this part, and I was like, wait, what? That's actually in the script? And that's actually a thing that happened. The guy's like making all these points and this and that. And I just went, yeah, but the thing with Martha being the same name of Superman and Batman, that's why they stopped fighting. He's like, okay, well. And I'm like, well, there's no okay, well. That movie sucked. I crush you, DC nerd. Like, no. Like, when have you seen it?
First of all, my favorite part of the story is that he's like, yeah, I got an argument recently. And I was like, yesterday? You're like, yeah.
It was like,
yesterday.
Man.
It was like years ago. I mean, yesterday.
Yeah.
I just picture you going down the street serving Marvel justice.
I can't. And then, we could go on and on about it. But
okay,
whatever,
speaking of good music placement, so I've never given credit to this yet, but I think that it should definitely get credit because in X-Men Apocalypse, when they introduce the actual Four Horsemen after they've been formed by Apocalypse, they actually played Four Horsemen by Metallica.
It's not when they introduce them all. It's when they fucking recruit that Dink Eyes Angel.
That's right. Yeah.
Hold on. What did you just say?
Dink Eyes. Yeah, wait.
Baloney arm and Dink Eyes.
Just the way I like to do it. Put it on my tombstone. That's it.
No, like the... you're right, though. It was like... what is it? The Angel of fucking Death there. What's his name? God, I can't his name. Help me out here. Yeah, anyway, Apocalypse recruits these guys, and when they finally go to fucking, why can't I remember his name? They're playing Four Horsemen by Metallica, and I was like, ooh, this is like excellent licensing opportunity.
Right.
Strongly done. I was very impressed.
Oh, you mean like the 14 times they played Iron Man in the Iron Man?
Yes.
Yeah. Like, this is perfect point.
Yeah. Like,
you just know that.
No.
No. It's way better than that, actually, is what I'm trying to say.
Right, right.
What was that guy's name?
Is it?
Archangel.
Archangel.
Bow.
Yeah.
Probably threw me off because he's an angel of death.
That's right. Yeah.
But yeah. Fuck, man.
If they would have played that song, now that would have been a lot fucking better.
Yeah. Angel of death.
Yeah. I never saw the last X-Men.
What the? You never saw the Apocalypse one?
No, no.
I brought this up earlier, but there's a reason why you're not going to see Wolverine played by Hugh.
They're going to do one more, and that's it.
I'll tell you why, though, because there's a scene where they nailed this scene where Weapon X. Yeah, he's old as fuck. Weapon X gets broken out by current X-Men.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
So he's wearing his goggles and hoses and all that shit.
Yeah.
And he turns around at one point and girl that plays Sansa Stark, what's her name?
Oh, the redhead. Oh,
Jean Grey. Jean Grey.
Yeah.
But
That's right. She plays that. She plays Jean Grey. Yeah.
She is 22 real life.
Super young.
Yeah. So she he's gonna beast on all of them. Yeah. Rah, 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 rah. Wolverine shit.
One more time.
Okay. So he's gonna beast out, and then she connects to him psychically and gives him back his memory or whatever.
Yeah, okay.
Part of his memory.
Yeah.
And they have this moment, and I just I'm looking, and this guy's he looks 55 to her 22, and right. and you're these two are supposed to out maybe.
Yeah.
You know, it's not.
So they'll have to get a younger.
Yeah.
They'll do one more Wolverine. Because apparently they're gonna make the next Wolverine 3 or whatever they're gonna call it. It's gonna be R-rated, apparently.
I hope
because
so
because of the success of Deadpool. Yeah. They're like, hey, Wolverine should be in. You're like, well, yeah, let's have that.
Hopefully they cast action hero Steve McGowan, because you are rare.
One, I mean, by the time I think I'll be done coming and up. So yeah, I'll be at the top.
Up and coming. You'll be up in there.
I'm coming and up.
Up
I'm
and
coming
there.
Up.
Yeah.
Yo.
He'll have come the jar right to the top.
Right to the top. Yeah.
I'm not coming in a jar.
Jesus,
coming
Jesus
in a jar.
Christ.
What's going on with you, Wolf? Everything okay at home? What's going on?
Is everything okay at home?
Jesus.
Been a tough couple weeks.
Ladies and gentlemen, Steve McGowan is a very funny individual, and if you can watch him live this weekend at
And he's only getting better because I'm up and coming.
That's right.
You can see me at the Royal City.
That Royal City, New West, British Columbia. If you go to LAFFLINES, go to LAFFLINES.com, LAFFLINES.com.
Can we do a little contest, because you're gonna put this. If the people that share this can get free tickets,
sure. If we have time right now, yeah. If we want to share,
so this is kind of weird because by the time when this goes up, if they have to listen, tell you what, when you fucking post this, but listen to the whole thing.
I don't want anyone to ever doubt our marketing prowess ever. This is how we're literally doing it right now. We're figuring this out. Okay, let's figure this out.
Do as you will.
If you share it, you'll be entered into a draw that Steve McGowan will decide on randomly.
Just share it. We'll fucking give you some passes.
And if you're a lady, Adam,
say the word
Steve
that
McGowan.
We say repeatedly throughout the episode.
That's right.
And
yes.
He's an up and coming
comedian.
He's
an up and comer. If you share this with the code word up and comer.
Okay.
Ta-da! Yeah, LAFFLINES this Friday and Saturday.
How can people follow you online if they want to, Mr. McGowan?
I'm all over Instagram at the Steve McGowan. Snapchat is the same. Twitter, I tweet, I twat.
You don't get enough credit for this, but your Snapchat is first click worthy all the time.
Thank you.
You highlight some of the craziest fucking things I've seen, and you're very funny, and I like that. That I meant to say this earlier. That girl that was dancing, is she a comic or no?
She is a mystery girl.
Okay. She is fucking fantastic.
She isn't even an up-and-comer. She's just been around.
Oh, okay.
And she is just the gem that I have acquired.
I see.
You're gonna see more of her, actually.
I would love that.
Yeah, you're definitely gonna see more of her.
I think because you would have noticed on your Snapchats on it. I think I replayed them 3 or 4 times.
Yeah.
So they're fantastic.
You know what's funny is that same weekend I actually lost my phone.
That was
the weekend. I
saved that one photo.
I was
I've
got some great snaps.
That was the same weekend that Sonny Dollywell. We all attended Sonny Dollywell's comedy special taping here in Vancouver
at the Rio. That's right. Yeah,
that was the Friday, I think, or Thursday, and you did the weekend with him then, right?
Yeah, we were at Yuck Yucks, and then he did the Rio. That's right.
That makes sense.
Yeah,
Mr. Saavedra, how can people follow you?
Me at the Saavedra or Michael A. Saavedra on Instagram.
Okay, and Mr. Wolf, how can people follow you online? Brow.
This is a bad idea.
He doesn't
idea.
Even know where he is right now.
I'm trying to do
What's the matter with you, Wolf?
No, Jesus. There's nothing the matter.
Jesus.
You can follow me at Wolf Show, not Worf Show, yeah. Because that is a show specifically about docs. This one is just Wolf Show, just like the animal.
The background of that story just makes so much sense. Like someone was like,
how can somebody follow you?
Worf Show?
Well, you don't want to follow the Worf Show, but the Wolf.
That's right.
Wolf Show, exactly.
And if you want to follow the podcast, you can do so at intergalacticinterviews.com. You can also search us on Instagram at Intergalactic Interviews, and you can also... subscribe to us on YouTube and Stitcher and iTunes and SoundCloud. I think we might be moving off SoundCloud soon, though, boys. I think we might just be going iTunes, YouTube, Stitcher. That might be the way to go. We've got Big McGowan on the house here, so...
And if you want 20% off of your float, floathouse.ca,
follow us there.
And you get code? Free robes when you
free robes. Yeah. Free that you'll hand back.
I mean,
just keep the robes.
They're amazing. But yeah, thanks. Big thanks to Floathouse, Andy, and Mike for having us out, and Steve McGowan, friend of the show.
Thank you very much for having me, guys. Thank you, man. Thank you guys very much. Yeah, it was a lot of fun. Fucking
very
sausage
much
hands
there.
In there, whatever they are.
Get your
blood. And yeah, we'll see you all next week. We love y'all. Boom. All day.
Yeah. See you.